I remember back during the 1990s when I was like 87 years old, when President Bill Clinton signed the Defense of Marriage Act, establishing that marriage was between one man and one woman. Today, forget about it. Now, the opposite is happening. The Senate is trying to codify into law same-sex marriage. The latest now is that the Senate will wait until after the midterms to take up the bill. Liberals say they still need some more time to get a few more votes. So this bill is called the Respect for Marriage Act. It already has passed the House. Obviously, it's much tougher in the Senate. Basically, what the bill would do, it would shift the power to define marriage to the federal government and require all states to recognize same-sex marriages. Now, folks, the fact that we even have a bill like this that is coming up for a potential vote, well, that's bad enough. And we're going to see if some of those rhinos rear their ugly heads and vote for it. But frankly, look, we shouldn't even be in this position in this country in the first place. And yet here we are. Now, I want to make something very, very clear. The gay lifestyle is a sinful one. And if you have an issue with that, please don't send me an angry email. I'm just your friendly neighborhood anchor. Take it up with God. That's what his word states. We're talking sexual perversion. It perverts God's intended view of sexuality. Here is Pastor David Wells of Graceway Baptist Church in D.C. this weekend talking about that issue from a biblical perspective. Have a look.
All holiness comes from the presence of God. Every victory over every temptation will come as you get closer and closer to Christ. Are you practicing proximity to God in every situation? Now, I've told you, with sexual development, there is expression. We don't even need to talk about that really because we live in an oversexed society. There is also suppression. Suppression leads to confusion, leads to hypocrisy, leads to debauchery, perversion. As a matter of fact, the Psychological Society and Sigmund Freud and all these boys have found that most psychological problems come from sexual suppression. Most mass murderers and insane people have some sort of sexual exposure in the past that they didn't know what to do with.
Well, joining me now is Pastor Brad Wells. There he is with Graceway Baptist Church in D.C. Pastor Wells, thanks for being here. I appreciate it.
David, what a privilege to be here with you today.
Well, take us through that sermon yesterday. I mean, I know you're a pastor. If I did that, you know, it'd be an hour and a half later, and I've got dinner plans at Chuck E. Cheese tonight. What do people need to understand when it comes to sexuality and the Bible?
First off, sexuality is a blessing from God. It's God's idea. It's what God created Adam and Eve for and with. It's one of our basic desires, but desire is to be devoted to God. Actually, that's a clip from the message that I just preached yesterday of the life of Joseph. And Joseph, of course, sold in as a slave into Egypt, all sorts of reasons to have psychological problems, but he didn't. As a matter of fact, he rose to second in command, basically the prime minister of Egypt, and saved the nation and saved the world. How did that happen? It was because he practiced closeness to God, proximity to God. I just to walk onto this little set here, I stepped away from the Beverly Hills Bagel Company, which is just tremendous. And I'm in this little Jewish community here in Beverly Hills. I'm about ready to go into a pastor's conference. And this lady walked up to my wife and my kids and I as we're sitting out eating bagels and drinking coffee. And she said, "Where are you from?" We're from D.C. And she was even further surprised. She said, "We don't see this. And I didn't think this was in D.C., our nation's capital." And my wife said, "What?" She said, "Modest people. You're happy. You're right in the public square. You're modestly dressed. What is the secret?" And we had just an incredible opportunity to show eternal truth, eternal scripture. And what we need to understand, David, is this is a social experiment that is being done on the American people. It's not new. Many, many other societies have tried other ways. The Bible declares there's one way, and that way is Jesus. And Jesus is the Messiah, the chosen one of God. And he shows the only way that man can live. And the Ten Commandments are not how to get to heaven. It's how to live on earth. Jesus is the way to get to heaven. But all of this has to flow through politics. Politics or policy is simply the feet of our faith. I really think, David, one of the main problems in the world today is we like to keep faith bound up in the book of faith, the Bible, or locked away in churches and religious centers.
Yeah.
And we fail to see that it's got to get into our heart and then come out of our mouth or come out of our life into the public community.
That's such a great point. There's so much to delve into here. Why don't we start with just the basic word of truth? I mean, we know that Jesus is the truth, the way, and the life. And so if we're going to talk about truth, you know, the liberals in America and the secularists and those that don't believe in God will say, well, my truth is not your truth. Your truth is not my truth. But there is truth. I mean, 1 + 1 = 2. There are a lot of things that are just what they are. How do we as Christians try to kind of work on folks that don't understand it this way, especially from a sexual perspective? Because, you know, nowadays, the pronouns are out of control. I mean, you know, what my pronouns are, me, myself, and I, by the way. But the point is that, you know, I mean, but this is crazy stuff. And yet we're the ones that are told that we're crazy. We know we're not crazy, but the society today wants to tell us that we're the outcast, and the Bible talks about that too. So go ahead, have at it.
Well, David, God's people have always had to stand alone. And that's from the human perspective. But from the eternal perspective, we are standing with God. God's not standing with us. We're standing with him. That's the fourth man in the fire in Babylon. That is Joseph in Egypt. That's Daniel there in Babylon. And that's us in the American community today. Our forefathers chose to stand alone, and God gave them leadership. And as we submit to the word of God and try to do good in our community, not become belligerent and arrogant and puffed up with pride, God can use us, and God is the one that advances us. Basically, what I'm saying is it's a miracle of God. And we can trust God to promote us at the right time, in the right place. Now, the foundation of all of this is human sexuality. That's why I think it's attacked by the enemy spiritually. It would be the devil, or in society, it would be the opposition to destroy us. That's why human sexuality is attacked so much. It's the temple of our heart. So the number one desire we have, I guess, would be to breathe. And number two would be to drink water. And number three would be eat food. Number four would be our creative element. That is sexuality. And it must be given back to God who gave it to us. Now, my truth, your truth, and all of this, once you get rid of truth by its definition, something that all society must live by, society is on a very slippery or precarious slope, and things will fall very, very quickly.
Well, you mentioned food, water. Yeah. A human will die without food and water. Just like the number four you were talking about, the creative being that God has made us, society can die out. Now look at the fall of the Roman Empire. I mean, it's that type of situation that we find ourselves in today. So talk to me a little bit about the deliberate, if you will, cultural Marxism that is out there that is trying to break down the paradigms, the traditional Judeo-Christian, biblical, God-breathed paradigms that are prevalent in our society today, but they're trying to get rid of them at a pretty quick clip here.
David, I think at the core of this whole movement is an anti-God. I would say it's a very spiritual thing. It's not atheist. God doesn't believe in atheists. I think there is two two parts here. One is the deceiver and the other's deceived. Now, I walk the halls of Congress weekly, and I've been doing it now for about 8.5 years. So I'm still kind of new, still trying to, learn the ropes, so to speak. And I've spoke to a great, powerful people. 2 weeks ago, I got to speak to Chuck Schumer. I've got to speak with Nancy Pelosi and and talk to these people. And I believe God has given me an audience with them. And I want to speak truth. I carry my little Bible around, and immediately that makes me stand out as a little bit different. And I like that. It identifies me not as somebody that's calling anyone to anything but the Word of God. I have no strength outside of the pages of the eternal book, the Word of God. But here's what I would say. I was surprised when I talked to Nancy Pelosi. I didn't feel an incredible evil or opposition or something destructive. And this might be a shock to a lot of our viewers here today. But I saw somebody that was deceived. I genuinely think that she is deceived and then therefore is perpetuating the deception. And the deception is, and I think the greatest enemy today, it's not communism or socialism or some other ism or schism. It's humanism. And humanism says, I am God, my way. This is my truth. I can rewrite it. I can do it. This is what I think. So now you must agree with what I think. I think I'm a woman. You've got to agree with me. And if you don't, well, I'm gonna sue you. And this has been done before. And it is the destruction of every society. I'm not saying everybody is trying to deceive, but there is deception and they are deceived. And then once you're deceived, you can work genuinely.
Sure.
But you're going the wrong way.
So let me ask you this as a follow-up, and I know you'll keep conversations between you and Nancy Pelosi and Chuck Schumer close and private.
Right.
I got that. But what is kind of like the tact or the philosophy or at least the goal? You're an inerrant Word of God guy. You're a Bible believing Christian. So how do you kind of approach folks like that when they're coming at it? And I don't want to put words in your mouth, but somewhat of a humanist perspective on this. What's the way you kind of you witness to folks like this? Because it's not easy.
Well, obviously, when you talk to somebody, you have to meet them on their ground. So the first thing I have to do is find some way to connect with them. So the policies that are being put forth are rooted and grounded on some sort of faith, on some sort of element of belief. And so it is essential that I connect with people and we connect. All of us connect with people on the truth, the relevant truth of the day. And then we've got to steer people to the eternal truth, the Word of God. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. And that is the incredible stabilizing factor of a community of faith. It's not based on some strong personality's opinion. It's based on something that won't change. That's what makes America unique with our Constitution. And it doesn't need to be rewritten. It needs to be reread, just like the very Word of God. We've got to get back to eternal truth.
Let me ask you a little bit as we wrap up here about the Gen Zers, the younger generation.
Yes.
I want to read you something Jonathan Capehart wrote on The Washington Post. He's a gay man, opinion editor for The Washington Post. He writes this: when I was the age of today's generation, Gen Z, being lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, queer, questioning basically any identity that wasn't heterosexual meant living in a nation that was neither tolerant nor accepting. Even in a gay Mecca such as New York, the few of us who were out of the closet were still seen as courageous. So imagine my pride in seeing Gallup's new data showing more and more Americans publicly embracing their sexual orientation and gender identity. 10 years ago, 3.5% of U.S. adults self-identified as LGBTQ. Today, it's a record 7.1%. And yes, it's largely Gen Z that has driven the increase in the figure, as well as in my hope for the future of this country. Of course, that type of stuff will be celebrated by liberals all over the country. We know that it's actually really sad that people are getting deceived by what God's best needs to be for them. What would you say about that? I've got about a minute or two here.
David, we are essentially a temple with five gates into the core, the throne room of our life, man's soul. Those are the five senses. And what sits on that throne is absolutely important. And so pride can sit on that throne. And pride is that element that is in opposition against God. Pride is the substitute and the imitation of honor. What we need is not pride. We need honor. Honor is what we can live for. Honor is what our forefathers died for. Pride and lust wish to fill our hearts. And they'll fill my heart, your heart, and anybody's heart if we allow sensuality, sexuality outside the boundary of marriage to enter our ears, our eye gates, and into that sacred chamber of man's soul that God created. And so there's only one thing that can fill that vacuum, that longing, that need in our heart. That's God. When our hearts are filled with God, it will push out pride. It will push out lust. And we can live in a life of honor and dignity. And our community will be restored. And that is back to the vision that our forefathers wanted and the prophets of old spoke of throughout the Holy Scriptures.
Pastor Brad Wells, real honor to have you on the show today. Thank you so very much. And you're in Beverly Hills now, you say, for today?
I'm just here for a few more hours, but yeah, it's a neat place.
Yeah, well, we got to get you on a street corner, I think, in Beverly Hills. That's for sure. All right, stat. All right, Pastor Wells, thanks so much for being here. Great stuff.
Thank you, sir.
Oh, that was great.